Welcome to this presentation from the Urban Penguin. My name is Andrew Mallett, and today we'll be looking at reading and writing to fields within Java. As always, you'll be able to find these videos on theurbanpenguin.com. On Twitter, you'll be able to follow me at theurbanpenguin. And if you're on Facebook, you'll be able to come across and like my page, and you'll find it as The Urban Penguin. So moving on then to our NetBeans IDE, you can see we've got a very simple class here, read-write, not a whole lot of stuff within it. We're looking at very simple mechanisms of being able to read and write to the fields. Of course, got to have some fields. So if we go through and create then within our main method a field called result, which you can see has been set up as a string. We can set up an integer L, which might represent the length, and an integer W, which might represent the width. So we can look at how we could possibly do some calculations across this. Of course, we've got to be aware of the different data types. Also, we're looking at the early stages of our learning here. So we could probably do these through getters and setters, so reading with get and setting through set. But in the simplest form, we could do something like L equals 2, W equals 5. So this is writing to the L and W field. If we wanted to calculate the result, then of course we've got to convert the integer values through to a string. So we could do string.value of, and then have our calculation, so L multiplied, so we're using the asterisk character there, W, end our line with the semicolon, and now we've read from the L, we've read from the W field, and now we can print it out from the result field that we've just written to by reading that in. So result is, maybe throw a colon in there for a little bit of tidiness, and then concatenate our text in print line with appending the result. Once we're ready, if we're in NetBeans, if I hit F6, the code will run, and you can see then we get 2 multiplied by 5, so we get a result of 10. Now, if we want to make this application a little bit more dynamic, we can look at reading in information to do the calculations. So I'm just going to import a Java package here. So I'm going to java.io.star. And then we're going to create a buffered reader object. So we can go buffered reader, br. For ease, I'll put it on separate lines. So I'll declare the variable br here, and then on the line below, we can then go br equals new buffered reader. The buffered reader object is coming from our java.io.bufferedReader class. I use the asterisk because we also need an input stream reader, and that's again coming from the same java.io package. So the buffer reader is going to be set up as an anonymous instance of an input stream reader, and our input stream reader is going to read in system.in, so our standard input. So of course we want to print out a little message on the screen so our users know to enter some data. So we might have enter length. We'll set up some temporary variables to hold the information and then convert them later. So I'm just going to go string SL and string SW. At this stage, we're going to use try and catch because we might have some issues reading from the input stream, and especially being in our main method, we should always put things that can fail, things that will throw exceptions or errors, inside try and catch blocks. So we're going to try then SL equals BR dot read line. And then of course the exception that we're going to get is an IO exception. All of this can be maintained by just checking up on what a buffered reader, an input stream reader, looking at the exceptions that they can throw. So if we have a problem populating SL, then we haven't read the line properly, so we can send out a message error in input and then perhaps exit out of the program. We'll look in more detail in later lessons at managing our exceptions, but as you can see here, it becomes quite simple: try and catch blocks. Of course we want to do something similar with string W, so our string width, so we can cut and paste these down. So now we're going to prompt to enter the width. Of course we're looking at very simple mechanisms. Again, some of this you might say, well, shouldn't be in our main code and should be in separate methods, and I would agree with that. But at the moment we're quite simply looking at how we can read to and write to fields. So within our try block now, we're setting the string width to be br.readline. Now we're ready to convert, and of course the conversions might fail, and this is quite likely because our users might not conveniently type in numbers, they might type in words or extra spaces or whatever. So again, I'm putting this within a try and catch block. So our L variable, which was an integer, is now going to look at integer.parseInteger, SL. We can see we get a little underline warning underneath the SL, and this will be telling us, well, it's possible that we haven't instantiated the value. So we've declared it, but say, well, what if it doesn't have a value? So I'm just going to go through then and put my string values through to an empty string. Now we're ready to do the same, so we can copy this line and set our integer width to be the value of integer.parseInt and reading in the string width. So Java is very type full oriented, so it strictly behaves with types, so we've got to make sure we convert them correctly. Now the error that this could then throw up would be a number format exception. So within our catch block we look for a number format exception. If we've got a number format exception, print out some form of method. So unable to convert, or whatever we feel is the appropriate message, and exit with some bizarre error code. When we normally exit, we would be exiting with a code of zero. So if we exit with a code of anything other than zero, we're indicating that the program errored in some way. Now we can delete the lines where we manually set the values, but we can see now in our result string.value of, we've got little underlines indicating that we've got problems or potential issues, so to say they might not be instantiated. So again, we might force them to start with a value of zero. To be honest, if they weren't instantiated, they would start with a value of zero being an integer anyway, but this then keeps NetBeans happy. So we've been through and looked at now providing a mechanism that we can read our standard input and populate that through to our length and width variables. Of course we had to convert some of our data, and again we'll look in more detail later at converting data. But again, a lot just depends on understanding the type of data you're receiving and what it needs to be translated or converted to. Once we're ready now, we can hit the F6 key. The code is going to be run. We're being prompted to enter the length, or we can put a value in. Let's say we'll put a value in at the moment of a length of 4 and a width of 5. So we've got a result of 20. Hopefully you found this useful, and thank you.